So let me now begin. So this is the introduction, and I want to first explain to you what this whole course is about. That is where we'll start. So I have listed here in a title the region, the contact and conflict which occurs when you put together quantum theory and general relativity. And I have listed three specific items. There is a reason for that, but let me run over the items one by one. The first is the definition of something called Planck's length square. This was known from the time of Planck. As soon as he found out that there is a h cross, which is the Planck's constant, he found that something with the dimension of length and therefore with the dimension of mass, time, etc., can be constructed out of these three fundamental constants. This is extraordinarily tiny. It is some 10 to the minus 33 centimeter in length scales. And there is enough theoretical evidence to suggest that something funny is going to happen at that scale, that you cannot measure intervals, proper times, etc., shorter than this length scale. So our normal notions of space-time, something should happen, etc., etc. What actually will happen? John Wheeler used to say that geometry changes into pre-geometry. But beyond that, John Wheeler had nothing further to say, and the whole question is, what is the correct pre-geometric variable? This is an open question. So this is clearly a point at which GR and QT, when you put together, something interesting happens. Now, there is also a very practical reason for this. Whenever you give a popular talk on cosmology, somebody will put up the hand at the end and ask, what happened before the Big Bang? Now, this is a profound question. It is not a silly question. Science is duty-bound to answer this question. Right now, science cannot. Okay? So all our equations fail when the curvatures of the universe, for example, is comparable in length dimension to this. So you need a quantum theory of gravity. So we escape in all the popular talks by saying we are waiting for that quantum theory of gravity. When it comes, I will come and give another talk, and I will explain to you what happened before the Big Bang. But from a very practical point of view, you need to do that. Now, you don't have to go back 13 billion years to see this. We know that astrophysically, black holes form by collapse of massive material. Now, if you put a person on the surface of that body, which is collapsing, we all have some colleagues whom we want to do this to. He will collapse, he or she will collapse with it. And they are going to ask you beforehand that I have a wristwatch in my hand. What is going to happen to me? I am willing to commit suicide, but what is going to happen to me as the time progresses in my wristwatch, in his proper time? It turns out that you have to say, I am sorry, I don't have the answer. Because you can predict it up to a point, but not beyond that. It is exactly as bad as saying that if I throw a ball up in the air, I can predict what is going to happen for 13 seconds, but beyond that, I cannot predict what is happening. The physics comes to an end at that point. And this is again because the curvatures are comparable to Planck length during the collapse. So we do not know what happens right at the singularity, so to speak. That is what that is the name we give for something we don't understand. At this time, it is also a good point to remember that the conventional approaches to quantum gravity, there are several of them, including string theory, loop quantum gravity, etc. All of them say something funny happens at this length scale. That is true. It is impossible to do any decent quantum theory of gravity without this propping up. But none of them have any clue what happened before the Big Bang or what happens at the center of the black hole. So when people say that a particular model of quantum gravity understands black hole, you should ask them, what happens at the singularity? There is no answer. So the current concepts of quantum gravity does not properly incorporate this, and we will come back to this. All the three points of contact and conflict which I am going to mention are the ones which are classic clues which you can write down, which are not properly incorporated in the conventional approaches to quantum gravity. That is why I am highlighting them. Now let me take the second one. In the previous slide, I said that nature has three fundamental constants, G, H cross, and C. That was wrong. There is sufficient amount of evidence, or at least there is nothing which contradicts the statement, that there are actually four fundamental constants in nature. The fourth constant is something called the cosmological constant denoted by lambda. Now, this lambda has dimensions of centimeter to the minus 2, and meter to the minus 2 for you SI guys. And g h cross upon c cubed has dimensions of LP square. So the product of this is a dimensionless number. And we know from cosmological observation that this number is extraordinarily tiny. Okay, of course, you don't measure this number directly. You measure other things and you infer this number. So anything which is this tiny, one would have normally thought should have been 0. And we would have been very happy this constant didn't exist. But there is observational evidence which is consistent with this quantity being non-zero and being yet another constant in the universe. Then the question arises as to why this is so tiny. What is the physical principle which fixes this number? And this number is very closely related to how the universe came into being and what are the parameters of this universe. So which again takes you back to the problem of cosmogenesis or what happened before Big Bang kind of a question. And we are again duty bound to come up with a principle which gives you this answer. We will spend a fair amount of time discussing the so-called cosmological constant problem. But just to give you a peep into what is happening, if there is no H cross, there is no cosmological constant problem. If you had only lambda, G, and C, you cannot construct a dimensionless number. Its value depends on what units you use. So this is the quantum gravitational problem. Okay. And the quantum gravity has to give you an answer to why this is so tiny. None of the approaches to quantum gravity, except the one which I am going to sell right at the end, none of the approaches to the quantum gravity has any clue as to how to tackle this problem. Okay. Even though everybody understands that this is an important issue and everybody acknowledges it, we don't have a way of going forward with it. So this is an important clue about what you should expect from a quantum gravitational model. That is, by quantum gravity, I always mean putting together the principles of quantum theory and general relativity. When you do that, you should have some insight into this problem. Now comes the third one. This is what I'm going to spend, again, a fair amount of time during the course, because it is concrete, it is doable, and it tells you something which is very profound and very deep. And again, it is something which is not taken into account in any of the conventional approaches to quantum theory. That is one reason why the standard quantum gravity programs, in my opinion, fails. The result tells you that if there is an acceleration g of a particular kind, you can associate a temperature with it, which is given by this formula, which is all of these are fundamental constants. This is not a fundamental constant. It came up because we didn't understand what heat was, and you inserted it. Normally, temperature should be measured in energy units, which means that there is no fundamental constant here. But h cross and c are fundamental constant. There is no capital G explicitly there. But most of the time, this acceleration is going to come from the capital G. A classic example of this is the temperature of the black holes, which, of course, because of brief history of time, everybody knows everything about it. Okay, so black holes have a temperature, and it comes from this formula, where the g happens to be the surface gravity of the black holes. But it happens in a much more profound way in the following sense. If you take a bottle of water and you run with it with an acceleration, the temperature you would attribute to the bottle of water is different from the temperature an inertial guy will attribute. And the acceleration with which you are running will come in here. This much will be the extra temperature to the lowest order. So this is a very real effect. That is a thermometer. If it is accelerated, normal clinical thermometer, if it is accelerated with an acceleration g, will give you this reading, except that it is so tiny that normal clinical thermometers won't do that. But in principle, you can prove this. You can actually prove this. And that is why I said this is beautiful, because this is one concrete result which we have, which can be reasonably rigorously proved. So why is it? And in general, what happens is that if there are regions which you cannot observe, there is a horizon beyond which you cannot see anything. Black hole is one example. An accelerated observer creates his own horizon. And there are several other cases. Whenever there is a horizon, you attribute a temperature to the horizon, which is given by this, where this g is the surface gravity of that horizon, which is defined in different contexts in a different way. So this gives you a very deep connection between thermodynamics and gravity, which you don't see anywhere else. I mean, electromagnetism and thermodynamics do not have any connection. Even though Planck's spectrum originated from electrodynamics, it is more to do with matter than to do with the electromagnetic interaction. So here there is a very fundamental connection between space-time and temperature, and it is very important in a fundamental theory to keep them together. If you don't, you will not get a successful theory of quantum gravity. Okay? So this is what the central theme of our lectures will be. I will run through in the 5 lectures all these problems. I will spend fair amount of time on this, and then I will also talk about cosmological constant, and in the last lecture or so the Planck length will also come in. Then I will try to give you a model which is what many of us have been working on here, called the emergent gravity paradigm, in which these 3 issues are taken into account and they are used as a guiding principle to arrive at a model for quantum theory and gravity. It is not a complete picture, but one has made some amount of progress, and it is a kind of a controlled expansion in the sense that you know exactly what you have done and what remains to be done. Okay, so this is going to be the plan of the lecture. So what I want to tell you in this context of this emergent gravity paradigm is that the final conclusion which emerges when you take all these into account, especially the problem of cosmological constant and the temperature of the horizon, is that classical gravity is like the thermodynamic limit of a fluid, and the fluid is space-time. So the equations of classical gravity is like Navier-Stokes equations and continuity equation, etc., for a fluid. And there is an underlying statistical mechanics which is what we need to discover. And it tells you some amount of clues as to how to go about it, but not completely, and you have to do that. Okay, now let us get on with the start. So it is about putting together quantum theory and general relativity, in particular quantum field theory, but quantum theory in general. So I want to start by talking about quantum field theory. Now in quantum field theory, the usual thing, many of you would have taken a course in quantum field theory, and you would have been taught that you take a field and you quantize it. There are excitations of this field that can be described by relativistic particles with a dispersion relation. This is a very natural approach, and this is what condensed matter physicists would use. They will have all kinds of particles, magnons, phonons, etc. They are all excitations of an underlying field. And at a fundamental level, you think that electrons and positrons and photons and everything are excitations of a fundamental field. But this begs a question which a smart kid should ask. Look, if I know the action for a classical mechanical system, say, I have a classical mechanics, non-relativistic mechanics, the action is, let us say, kinetic energy minus potential energy. Then there is supposed to be a path integral formulation by which you can construct a quantum theory. Of course, we know the action for a relativistic particle. So why not take that action and construct a quantum theory for a relativistic particle? Why do you need a field? Why do we need to describe relativistic particles as excitations of the field? So I need to explain to you how to go from a relativistic particle to field. It turns out that if you take the action for a relativistic particle and do things properly, the mathematics will pop up and tell you that I am a field. And I will show you how that comes about. And that is extremely important. The field to relativistic particle, I will probably spend 5 minutes, because this is something which you have learned from all the textbooks. It is the other part which I need. And this is what we are going to begin with. So this is going to be an introduction to quantum field theory and concepts in quantum field theory which we need for the rest of the talk. Now, this question also has a slightly deeper issue. The first question is that we are talking about putting GR and quantum theory together. And special relativity and quantum theory is supposed to have been put together very successfully. After all, we have the standard model of particle physics which has won so many Nobel Prizes, and it is fantastically in agreement with the experiment. And it puts together principles of relativity and quantum theory. So at a technical level, there is absolutely nothing wrong. But conceptually, the same kind of results can be viewed from very many different points of view. And when you go beyond the restricted domain, certain points of view might generalize, the others won't. Let me just give you a simple example, because you might not have thought of it like that. If you are doing classical mechanics, Resnick and Halliday classical mechanics, you can use either velocity or momentum. Momentum is just m times v. Now you keep talking about velocity of particles, velocity of sliding ladders, etc., 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 and everything works out. And the momentum and velocity are equivalent perspectives in classical mechanics. But the moment you leave the comfort zone of non-relativistic quantum mechanics, you will find that momentum is a lot more fundamental than velocity. For example, if you do electromagnetic field, it has a momentum, it doesn't have a velocity. I mean, don't confuse with speed of light. The electromagnetic field equations do not have, electric field and magnetic field do not have velocity, they have momentum. Okay? And the same thing happens in quantum theory. It is much nicer to quantize things in terms of momentum and position rather than with velocity and position, etc., etc. So some two different perspectives which is equivalent in a restricted domain, very often in physics you find that one perspective is much more useful when you are extending. So it is always important to look at quantum field theory and putting together of special relativity and quantum theory and ask whether there is an alternate perspective you can have which may be more useful when you are going beyond this domain to GR, beyond the domain to quantum gravity. What do I mean by that? So, I have written a question here which is sort of rhetorical, so don't take it literally. But this is a question which you need to address at some stage. When you say quantum gravity, you are talking about quantizing the gravitational field. Good, fine. But ultimately, you also want to know what the normal matter fields of the standard model is going to behave close to Planck scales or Planck energy. When space-time itself becomes pre-geometric, you have no time, you have no space, you can't write a wave equation because wave equation involves t and x and you don't have a field, how are you going to describe the matter set? So this is what I meant by saying how will you describe this. This is not a deep problem, that's why I said it's kind of rhetorical question. The correct question to ask is, do we need a different description of matter interacting relativistically when you go close to Planck scales? And all indications are that we will need that because you may not be able to exceed Planck energy, and if you collide two particles in such a way that the collision energy is much larger than Planck energy, some new phenomena is going to take place and they have to be inculcated into it. So the general reference to this first part of this is, not surprisingly, my own book on quantum field theory. There is also a paper which you can find in archive where you will find much more details on these questions because the textbook material appears in the textbook, but that is a very sanitized thing. So if you really want to look at deeper issues, they are described in this. Okay? So these are the two general references which you could compare. Okay. Now let us go further and let me explore in greater detail the connection between a particle and a field. So let us start with non-relativistic quantum mechanics. In non-relativistic quantum mechanics, this is the standard time. And this is space, it is x, y or z. Now, this is a path and the non-relativistic quantum mechanics can be obtained by writing down a propagator for it to go from some point x1 to some point x2. Actually not point, event x1 to event x2. So a word about notation. If you don't find any boldface or some funny twiddle here, etc., etc., they represent four-dimensional objects. So this x1 corresponds to t1. X1, Y1, Z1, the other corresponds to T2, X2, Y2, Z2, okay, it's a condensed notation. So from one event to another event, if a particle is propagating, you can talk about events even in non-relativistic quantum mechanics because you need time and space to describe anything. It is supposed to be a sum over exponential I times the non-relativistic action over all paths which connect these two endpoints. So if you look at a path, the path can go like this. When I am plotting time against any of the axes. But suppose I plot the same thing as a path, the way we think of a path. Path is something which happens in space. If you plot y-axis against x-axis, the projection could be something like this. Very precisely, people should call this a history and this a path, but we will use them interchangeably. A history is something which evolves as a function of time, and path is something which at a given time does something. Okay? But I will not be very careful about that. But what is important is that a path can go round and round in space and it can be at three different x-axis at a given y-axis. It can just do whatever, okay? It can be going around in a circle. It cannot do it in time. In time, it cuts the t is equal to constant surface only once because you have one particle and that particle is going like this. This is how you build your non-relativistic quantum mechanics. And these paths go back and forward in space, but not in time. You can immediately see a problem when you bring in relativity. Because relativity tells you that you have to deal with space and time in some kind of an equal footing, not identical, but somewhat equal footing. So what happens there is that if a particle is moving from place to place, it carries a clock. In relativity, all particles carry clocks. So when it is carrying a clock, it has a proper time in shown by this clock. And you can plot the trajectory. Now it is a t as a function of tau, tau is the proper time, x as a function of tau, y as a function of tau, z as a function of tau. That is what gives you the trajectory in space-time. And sure enough, in the space-time, it cuts the proper time only at one point. Because if you say the clock reading was something, it was at some point in space-time. Okay? But now your t has been downgraded to something like a spatial variable. Therefore, if I look at paths which has to contribute into this path integral, you have to take into account a path like this. Because just like I told you here, the y-axis, x-axis, you can do this. And in this particular case, time is just like a y-axis. Okay? The space and time are not different. So paths like this is going to contribute here. So what it means is that the paths can go backward and forward both in space and in time. Now, this introduces something very, very peculiar. You have to incorporate paths like this, which means that a particle was in three different places, 1, 2, 3, at a given time. You started with one particle, and suddenly you find there are three particles hanging around at three places. Much worse, I have to take into account paths which go, which go any number of times, right? That means a particle can be at infinite number of places at a given point in time. This is an inevitable consequence of special relativity. Now, a particle is a degree of freedom for you. So, if you have a particle in three dimensions, it requires three numbers to specify. So, there are 3 degrees of freedom. Ignore things like spin and all that sort of stuff. So, you need 3 degrees of freedom minimally. So, if a particle is going to sit at three different places, it is like 3 particles, then you need 9 degrees of freedom. So, if the particle is going to zigzag all over, you need something which has infinite number of degrees of freedom on this surface. So, you have 2 choices here. One choice is you can say, forget this time, I'm going to travel along with the particle, with its clock time and proper time, and I will do everything. It turns out you can do that. It's an enormous mess. And it is not very elegant except when you go beyond scalar field. And this has been attempted, but it is not so good. What we would like to do in physics is to evolve things from one time slice to another time slice to another time slice to another time slice. We want to go forward in the coordinate time, which you can do. But then in this coordinate slide, you better have something with infinite number of degrees of freedom. Now, a thing with an infinite number of degrees of freedom is called a field. And since it is quantum mechanical, it's called a quantum field. That is why relativistic particles require a quantum field for their description. But then there is something more serious to this. You should be able to get the propagator. See, given the action, I have told you that you can compute the propagator. It is even written down somewhere here. Given the relativistic action, we do know what is the action for a relativistic particle. So I can do this sum. It's not as trivial as non-relativistic quantum mechanics, but it's doable. I will show you how to do that. Then you will get this quantity. But now I'm going to say that, look, I can describe it with an infinite number of degrees of freedom in a field. So I should be able to get the same propagator from the field as well. So this is the miracle of quantum field theory. You can describe the so-called propagators, which are the fundamental construct from which everything else can be built, either from a relativistic path integral, or by writing down some infinite number of degrees of freedom, they will be usually be harmonic oscillators, either interacting or non-interacting. So the infinite number of harmonic oscillators will arrange themselves in such a way that it gives you back the same propagator. So this is the miracle which I want to describe to you, because this oscillator and this picture is going to play a continuous role all throughout our lectures, and it is important to get it out of the way and understand it properly. Okay, so let us start with this non-relativistic action principle which I talked about. So the first thing is that in quantum mechanics, there are amplitudes and probabilities. So people usually say that classical mechanics is deterministic and quantum mechanics is probabilistic. That is completely wrong statement. Quantum mechanics is amplitudistic. Probabilistic, even in classical mechanics, statistical mechanics is probabilistic. Probability is not the issue. For example, if you have two slits and you throw electrons at it, you know that there is an interference pattern on the other side. Any experimentalist will tell you that if you chuck an electron at a slit, there is a definite probability that it will go through the slit. It is not always one. That is called experimental uncertainty. So there is always probability in any such experiment that will not get you the interference, because probabilities are positive semi-definite numbers. If two slits are open, the probability to get you an electron there can only be greater than what you can get with one slit open. They do not interfere. Probabilities never interfere. So if quantum mechanics is just probabilistic, you won't get interference. What happens in quantum mechanics is that there is amplitudes. Amplitudes are complex numbers which interfere, and the probabilities are obtained by adding up the amplitudes for different events and then taking a mod square. Here you get a interference, and that is the central idea of the quantum mechanics. So how do I write down the amplitude? Now you want to look at, for example, you can do this. This is a very general principle, and it can be used for any system which you can conduct. But let us restrict to particles moving. So then you want to know what is the probability for a particle to go from one point to another point. For that, you need the corresponding amplitude. So this amplitude is what I am going to call as the propagator. So this is the amplitude for a particle to propagate from an event x1 to event x2. Remember, this is four-dimensional objects. So this rule tells you that you have to sum over all different histories which connect these two points. What we are going to do is something which we saw in a previous picture, but let me just draw this once again. So you have two points. This is time and this is space. And you think of one path like this, and you take another path like this. These are paths, and the paths are what I have denoted here by x of t, and the endpoints are x1 and x2. All the paths connect these two endpoints. And I have to give some amplitude for a particle to go from this point to this point along any one path. Then I have to sum over all the paths, and then I am done. Okay? Now, what could be this amplitude? This has to be postulated, but I can motivate the postulate. You cannot derive it from anything more fundamental. The claim is that you can write this in this form. So let me explain this. First of all, you say that all paths are equal. There is a democracy of paths, which means that the probability for any given path, which is the absolute square of this quantity, just one given path, should not depend on the path, which means it should be a pure phase, e to the I theta, so that the mod square is 1. I mean, that is normalization which I can check into this. So it should be e to the I theta. Now, what should be the form of theta? Now, in the form of theta, you want to throw in an idea that there has to be a classical trajectory which you should come about in some particular limit. For example, you are saying that an electron, when it goes from here to here, or rather if an electron was found here and later found here, it could have gone through any of these paths. But classically, billiard balls will go along a unique path. So there must be a way of getting the unique path out of these various paths. And that is, there you go to an analogy in optics. In optics, we know that you are describing light as an electromagnetic radiation, and it is a wave propagation. But ultimately, you can do ray optics where the light is going from point to point along the normals to the wavefronts. How does it come about in electromagnetism? That is completely well understood. There is a wavelength lambda, and when that limit goes to, when you take the very short wavelength, only one path comes out and everything else goes away. So you play the same game. You assume that there exists a parameter h cross which is universal, and then for every system you allot an object called A, which is called the action, and then you say that if I have this form like this, when h cross goes to 0, only the path for which A does not change to first order will get picked out. Therefore, it looks like a very reasonable idea. Why can't h cross for an electron be different from h cross for a proton, which is different from h cross for a billiards? Nobody knows. Okay? So there is a universal h cross, which when you take the limit, you get from, because in the optics analogy, the lambda for each radiation is different. So if you push that analogy a little bit too far, you will get stuck because the H cross are not different, okay? Now, action and H cross has the dimensions of angular momentum. Now, this sometimes confuses people because they ask, why should it be angular momentum, why can't it be? That is not really a worry, because instead of H cross, I could have put C H cross and C times action, and I could have called C H cross as my H cross and C times action as my new action. So the dimensions are really not so important. What is important is that it is a unique number which you are throwing in there. Now, while on it, I should say something. It turns out that there is a fine structure constant which is E square by H cross C, which is a dimensionless number. So whatever you can do with H cross, somebody can do with E square by C into 1 over 137. You don't need a fundamental error constant. You can get it out of E square and C. So when Planck first found H cross, he did realize that it has the same dimensions as E square upon C, okay? But of course, everything will go wrong by a factor 137, and radiation laws 137 is a big enough number to know that this is not that. And in most of the time, you don't introduce that because after all, E square is at the charge of the electron, how can it play a significant act? So this is to tell you that I cannot cheat you by saying from dimensional considerations you get it. No, because from dimensional consideration, E square by C is as good as H cross, okay? That is not something which is often appreciated. It is there in Berkeley Physics Course, Quantum Mechanics Volume. I mean, it's a classic text, but somehow people haven't picked it up. Okay, so you say that this should be the amplitude where this A has to be postulated for every system. Now, what is brilliant and what you should take back is that the entire nature, I don't mean particles going from place to place, everything which is known to humanity can be described by this principle. Okay, we do not know a single fundamental system whose equations cannot be derived from an action principle in the classical limit, and whose quantum theory you can show will not come from this principle. I mean, very often you will find that the sum over parts you cannot compute. But there is no proof that something funny is going to happen in quantum theory. There is a correction to this or something like that. We don't have any evidence. So it is a very universal fundamental physical principle which we have. It's a good place to start. Okay, now let us take the action, and what would you like to attribute as the action for a normal particle? Here you find something remarkable, and this is the first place where general relativity and quantum mechanics comes together. Since it would have never been taught in this form, except in some of my lectures, let me spend some time with that. The point is the following. Suppose you have a particle which is, you have a path, this is the same picture as above, but now I just want to concentrate on one path. So you have a path like this in space-time, and you want the path to start here and end up here, and you want to write the amplitude for that. So a natural thing to do is to find the amplitude for it to go from some small point to small point, and then you keep multiplying all those amplitudes because I don't care about that. Which means that in the exponential, you are going to sum over that. Now, what is the most natural thing you can write down for a small element which goes from some point x to x plus dx, four dimensional? So, to be precise, it is xi and xi plus dxi. Those in the back, imagine that it is written here because I am sure you won't be able to see. This is xi is one event. The other event is xi plus dxi, okay? Now, you want something in between, which is linear, and which is going to sort of integrate to a nice quantity for the whole path. So the most obvious thing is the length element, dl. So if I take that the action is dl here, then if I just sum up all the action, I get the fold length. That is very good. So we have found the action for a particle. No, hold on for a second. If you try to do this in classical mechanics, you will get a big blank zero. This path is a path in space-time. Newton never knew anything about paths in space-time. Newton didn't know about space-time. He knew about space, Lagrange and Newton and all these guys who developed action principles in classical mechanics, developed it with pure space. Okay? Now, something which you will keep seeing in this course and if you are watchful in all your courses is that exact theories are much more beautiful than approximate theories. So if you are doing an approximate classical mechanics, you have to postulate the form of the action. you will say it is like kinetic energy or kinetic energy minus potential energy or some such thing. And it has no physical meaning. In the exact theory, it has a simple physical meaning. It is just the length of the path. Because in an exact theory, you can define a length in the space-time. To define length in the space-time, you need special relativity. If you want to define a length in the space-time, in the presence of a gravitational field, you need general relativity. Without these constructs, you cannot naturally obtain the action principle. Now, of course, you can say, I will postulate the action. Sure, you can do that. I mean, you might as well postulate the equations of motion and be done with it. Okay? But if you want to look at it with a minimal postulate, then if you look at the exact theory, it comes about very naturally. So what you do here is that you are going to take the C, the entire amplitude, to be the product over amplitudes for each tiny piece here. And that tiny piece is some dLn, which is the length element of the nth piece. And that is divided by h cross. There is a constant of proportionality. So slight notational issue, n denotes which cut. I mean, you know, I am dividing it in 1, 2, 3, 4, n. While the m just tells you that this constant can depend on the mass of the particle, because that is the only quantity which is available there for a single particle with no other degrees of freedom. So you do this product, and that is over a sum. So you get IKM by h cross summation over dl. So this is going to be IKM by h cross integration of the length in the space-time between two events. This is what you do. Now what about KM? What is that? Now the final result which you have got is this is just the length, which is very beautiful because it is a geometrical object which is playing the role of the action. The propagator, when you want to get this KM, it is going to depend on the mass of the particle because we already know there is a concept of a mass of the particle. But at a more fundamental level, you can just write this as MC because other people have done it before you and define this as the mass. The coefficient of the action to the length is the mass. In fact, if you read Lando volume 1 classical mechanics, that is what he will do. He will first show that for a free particle, the Lagrangian can depend only on the velocity and it can depend only on the square of the velocity. And then he will say there is a proportionality constant between Lagrangian and the velocity square, which we will write as half m, where m is called the mass of the particle. So that immediately tells you what mass is. And here the action, that is exactly what we are doing. So you have got this. So what does it give you? Let us work it out for a special case. So I am now going to, we want the length in space-time. So you need a definition for that. I'm going to assume that everybody knows some amount of special relativity, if not general relativity. So the length square is c square dt square minus dx square. One word about notation. Here I am writing it as c square dt square minus, of course this is, you can see that boldface there, so it is dx square dy square dz square. But sometimes you can also write minus c square dt square plus dx square. Okay, this is called the signature. Now there is this philosophy that you have to be consistent and you should use the same signature. You should use the same signature on the right hand side and left hand side of the same equation. That much I will accept, but beyond that it is not necessary. And then it is also very important that you guys know how to switch between the signatures. Very often we will go from Lorentzian spacetime to Euclidean spacetime where t will become I times t. Then it is much nicer to use the other signature. While in particle physics it is better to use this signature. So I will switch between signatures, but I will caution you about that. And it is important for you to understand how to switch. Okay, so let us take this. And then if you write this, it is just integral square root of this ds square. So you take a dt square out, so it is ds square upon dt square square root times dt. So what do you get? You get this ds square by dt square, you will have a c square which you pull out. Then it is 1 minus dx square by dt square, which is v square. So you get integral 1 to 2 dt, 1 minus v square by c square to the power half. This is the action for a free particle. Okay, and this particular quantity which is inside the dt integral is called the Lagrangian for a free particle, and we have derived it from a completely geometrical reason. And of course it will give you classical mechanics and things like that, which we will come back to in a minute. So you have one place where you know what is ds square and you could do this. There is another place where you know what is ds square. This is for a weak gravitational field. So in a weak gravitational field, what happens is that the ds square can be expressed in the form 1 plus the Newtonian potential phi of the gravitational field, 1 plus 2 phi by c square times this quantity. I will derive that for you in a few slides down the line. It takes 5 minutes. Okay? It is nothing deep. It has, of course, you know gr, then you will know this because it is the linear limit of gr. But if you are going from this direction, it is 5 minutes, so which we will do later. But let us assume for a minute this is true. Okay? That is, in the presence of a gravitational field, the length between two events get modified by this. This one is what is there, and 2 phi just connects to it. So then what happens? You do exactly the same. You have mc l by h cross, which is integral over ds square. So you take the dt square out and put a square root. Now, what you have done is that you have taken a dt square out of this and put a square root. And dt square, when you take here, it will become dx square upon dt square v square by c square. And then you have a phi by c square and you have a square root. I said this is a weak gravitational field, which means that phi by c square is a small quantity and v by c is a small quantity. So you take a Taylor series expansion. So you keep all these things there. And this quantity, 1 plus something, is going to become 1 plus half of this minus half v square by c square. So now you can take this 1 and integrate it out. You will get mc square t2 minus t1. If when you are going to put this theta as exponential I theta, right? So when you do that, exponential I times this is just a phase which depends on t2 minus t1. And the remaining part of the action divided by h cross looks like a nice non-relativistic action which you can have, which happens to be kinetic energy minus potential energy for this case. So this is again another useful myth to shatter. There is a lot of textbooks anyway, they will tell you that in mechanics or in physics or whatever, Lagrangian is kinetic energy minus potential energy. You are not supposed to ask why, because that is a postulate. But the point is that it is not a postulate, it is plain wrong. There is only two systems which we know for which Lagrangian is actually kinetic energy minus potential energy. One is particle in a weak gravitational field, which is this. The second is electrostatics. No magnetic field. If you have even a static magnetic field, Lagrangian is not kinetic energy minus potential energy. Okay? And of course, if there is a time dependent electric field, there will be a magnetic field which will be lurking around. So in electrostatics, it is true. And in weak gravitational field, it is true. Yeah. That's correct. That's correct. That is correct. I mean, to be absolutely precise, non-relativist. Yeah. So I thought I will shatter one myth at a time. Okay. So there is no system which we know for which the Lagrangian is kinetic energy minus potential energy. I mean, it was sort of drawn to my attention because I had to referee a paper where somebody explains why it is true. So I had to first tell him that this is not true, and if you have explained it, then that explanation must be wrong. Okay. So every once in a while, people come up with explanations for that. But remember that that is an approximation, and this approximation came out of it. Now I want to come to the point which Azim was rising. Let us assume there is no gravitational field, okay? I mean, this we sort of did put the gravitational field, and now I'm going to take the gravitational field back, which is just like taking the original Lagrangian I wrote down here for a free particle. And let us look at the non-relativistic limit of it, okay? So let us go back. And if you take the non-relativistic limit, what the textbook will tell you is that, oh, that is fine. You just throw this away, and this is half mv square. This is a phase, okay? And that is how you get the non-relativistic limit of a relativistic system. This is again wrong. If you take the action for a relativistic free particle, which is here, this is exact true physics principle. This has no non-relativistic limit. If you take, say, going to infinity limit in it, it will blow up on your face, which is exactly what you see when you do here, that when you take C going to infinity limit, this will blow up on your head. Okay? So the argument is that, oh, it doesn't matter. I can subtract out mc square. I have actually seen this statement in textbooks, that you can subtract a constant from the Lagrangian, and it does not change the equations of motion. So I will subtract mc square. Then everything will be fine. No, everything will not be fine. Because if you subtract mc square and you multiply it by dt, that action will not be Lorentz invariant, because dt is not a Lorentz invariant object. In fact, it is almost a theorem that you cannot construct any Lorentz invariant free particle Lagrangian, which when c going to infinity gives you half mv square. It cannot be done. So what you do is you live with this. You say that this is a phase, I am going to take care of the phase in some limit, and I will work with this. It is fine. And as far as equations of motion are concerned, it is fine. But I am just cautioning you that don't believe everything you read in textbooks. Okay, so even good textbooks say this. Fine. Now I told, okay, that I think I have actually emphasized it here. Okay, caution textbooks, but I already told you this. So you cannot derive it from there without doing something shady, and the shady thing is putting into a phase an infinite quantity, which is what you are going to do. You cannot cancel it out by subtracting mc square, because that will break the Lorentz invariance, and that is very important. Okay, now let us go a bit further, which is to tell you why this is true. I could have just told you that go and read your GR text, but that is unnecessarily mystifying the thing. This has nothing really to do with GR. It comes from special relativity plus principle of equivalence. So let me just tell you, give you a runaround as to how you get this. What does it mean? What it means is something very physical. In special relativity, you know that if a particle is moving with a velocity v, a clock is moving with a velocity v, the clock will slow down. But if two clocks are kept stationary, they don't move with respect to each other, then it won't slow down. They will show the same time. But in general relativity, if you keep one clock on the table and one clock on the ground, the clock on the ground will slow down because it is in a deeper gravitational potential. What it means is that if I put dx equals 0, the time dt, which I measure as a coordinate time, and the time theta as measured by the clock, the intrinsic clock at the rest prime of the clock, are not the same. They are multiplied by this factor 1 plus 2 phi by c square. So that is all I have to derive. I have to show you that gravity affects clock rate. And then this is the simplest modification of the metric which will take that into account. Okay? So how do you show that? Well, you do a thought experiment. First you go back to what Einstein called his most beautiful thought, that if you are in a freely falling frame, gravity disappears. So in the freely falling frame, I can use special relativity. And in special relativity, we know clocks go slower. We even know exactly how it goes slower. Therefore, I can figure out in gravity how it will go slower. So these are inverts. The way you do this is the following. You take a wall like this wall, and you put clocks on it, A, B, Z. They are stuck to the wall. And then you have another clock which is falling from infinity, and at infinity it has zero velocity. So by the time it has reached some point, its velocity v square will be minus 2 phi x, where phi is the gravitational potential, conservation of energy. Half mv square plus phi is constant, and the constant is 0 at infinity. So v square is minus phi of x. So this is a freely falling clock. So if I sit on the freely falling clock's frame, I can do special relativity. So I sit on that frame, then I find that this clock is going up, this clock is going up, this clock is going up. I'm crossing it at different times when I have different velocities, so they will be going up with different velocities. Stick to one clock that is going up with a velocity v square equal to 2 phi. So special relativity immediately tells you that for a small incremental time, the delta t in the inertial frame, which is the freely falling clock, and the delta t of a fixed clock are related by 1 minus v square by c square. This is special relativistic time dilation. Then this v square from this equation you replace by minus 2 phi by c square, and you get this result. Now you can write it in a slightly nicer form. You can think of this as this quantity which you get, or rather you can think of this quantity when phi is equal to 0 to be equal to this. So the time interval in a gravitational potential phi is the same as the time interval in no gravitational potential multiplied by this. This is exactly what we have done there. Okay? In a static frame, you have just added that. What if it is moving? Even that you can take care of. It is slightly more complicated. That dt square will give you the standard special relativistic time dilation. So we have used this principle of equivalence and gravity, and then we have obtained the action for a particle in a gravitational field. It has the form kinetic energy minus potential energy, because the action is a nice, beautiful geometrical variable. It is the length of a path. Not because your Lagrangian is kinetic energy minus potential energy. Because the relativistic particle knows what is the correct Lagrangian, and when you take the non-relativistic limit, you get the correct result. Okay, let us go a bit further. So this is what I have called a rapid recall, just to orient you that what happens in the classical limit. So in the classical limit, you are going to take the variation of this delta A. So if you take the variation, first you get a dl by dv or dl by dx dot times d of delta x dot and plus delta x by delta x. This is, I'm sure all of you have done this. Then you move it to this side, and then you have a total time derivative which you integrate, it gives you this quantity. And then inside you have a dl by dx, and then you have a p dot coming from dt acting on this with a minus sign. So this time delta x equals p delta x. This, up to this point, we haven't assumed anything. We have just done the variation on delta A for a path. Now you can think of two kinds of variations. One kind of variation where you keep delta x fixed at the endpoints, and then you say that delta A should be an extremum. That will give you the equation of motion, which is just p dot d by dt of this, the Euler-Lagrange equations. And if you consider the Lagrangian for a particle in a gravitational field, it will immediately give you dp by dt is minus m del phi. Okay? You can also do another variation in this. You can say that I am going to ask how much is the change in delta A if I fool around with the endpoint. That is, I just vary delta x at the endpoint, but I am only going to consider those paths for which the equations of motion hold, so that this term is zero. If you do that, then you will find that this delta p is just dac by dx. That is the variation, because that comes from this. This is delta A, this is delta x, so p is delta A by delta x. So that tells you that p is dac. The classical action along that trajectory divided by dx gives you p. And then you also define a Hamiltonian as px dot minus l. And you can show by a similar argument that the Hamiltonian is minus dac by dt. You can even write these things nicely together. This is classical mechanics. No, I mean, okay, it could be a more general system, but even in classical mechanics, these relations hold. And if you think of pi as a four-dimensional object, E and P, pi with a lower index, I'm using a signature plus, minus, 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 at least this time. So E remains the same, P becomes minus P. Then the P with the lower end will have a minus P. And then di denotes d by dxi, it is d by dt, and d by dx, d by dy, d by dz. So both this result and this result flows out in a nice four-dimensional way. This is interesting. How did classical mechanics know about relativity and four vectors and momentum and energy or four component vectors, et cetera, et cetera? It actually doesn't. This thing actually comes, if you go back to the way action principle was derived by Hamilton, Jacobi, and all that, they had used tremendously the wave optics to ray optics analogy. Okay? And there you have the concept of kx minus omega t. Kx minus omega t is there even in classical mechanics. So the variation of the phase with respect to time and variation of phase with respect to position gives you two natural quantities which later on gets identified with momentum and energy. And that is how sort of relativity without relativity comes up here. Fine. Now again on rapid recall, if you do the same thing for a relativistic particle, you will have this result, because you take the Lagrangian to be square root of 1 minus v square by c square, and you can compute the energy, which is p times v minus l. So when you are computing the energy, you are expressing it as a function of x and x dot, and this is what it will be. This is well known. But if you rewrite the same thing in terms of momentum, you have to substitute this for velocity, and the Hamiltonians are functions of momentum, while energies are functions of velocities and position. And the Hamiltonian p of x will be, if you work it out, you get this result. That is, h square will be p square c square plus m square c to the power. So this is standard special relativity. I just wanted to recall it for you, because when you are doing relativistic quantum field theory, this kind of relations will come up. Okay. Now let us work out the propagator in non-relativistic quantum mechanics. I'll go till something like 5:45 and then stop, and stop for questions, or maybe 5 more minutes and then stop for questions. So I'm going to now set h cross equals 1 and c equals 1. That is again something which you should get accustomed to. The earlier you get to into it, the better. And we want to look at the non-relativistic propagator. So what does a non-relativistic propagator do? It gives you the amplitude for a particle to go from t1 x1 to t2 x2. Now suppose the amplitude for the particle to be at x1 at time t1 is given by psi, which is what you normally call a wave function. Then you multiply it by the amplitude for it to go from here to here. And you say that I don't know which x1 it came from, so integrate over all x1. Then you will get the amplitude at a later time. So the propagator has to propagate the wave function from one point to another. Then of course you can write the propagator as some kind of a sum over parts of this, and then that quantity will propagate this. But this immediately tells you something about the propagator. Now if I start with a psi and then I propagate it to psi 2, and then I hit it with another g and propagate it from here to some psi 3, okay, that is same as propagating original psi 1 to psi 3. This will hold only if the propagator satisfies a transitivity condition. So this is the probability amplitude for the particle to be x1, no bold, which means this is four dimensional. There is a t1 and boldface x1, and it goes finally to t2 and boldface x2, that is what this object is. And in between it halts for a moment at another point y, which is y0 and the spatial vector y, and it goes from y0 to spatial vector y. But I only integrate over the spatial part of ddy. That is because when you are propagating things like this, you only integrate over the spatial parts. Okay? I want you to grasp that point, because this relation is remarkable. Left hand side is independent of y naught, this quantity. But the right hand side depends on y naught. So if you throw in some arbitrary function here, it won't work. So it already tells you that the propagators are very restricted class of functions. And in fact, to show you the power of that, I will get for you almost the form of the free particle propagator just out of this. I don't have to sum the action. What you do is that you also, okay, one more thing which I should mention because it might come in later on. The propagator also satisfies a boundary condition that if you put these two time symbols equal, it should be a Dirac delta function. Why? Because take this t2 and put it equal to t1. So it means that after doing this complicated integral, I am going to reproduce this object again. That can happen only if this is a Dirac delta function. Okay? So there is a boundary condition on this propagator, and it has to satisfy this property which I call transitivity. Now, just from this transitivity, you can discover a lot about a propagator. So the way to do this is to Fourier transform it. So you take this g y to x, you do a spatial Fourier transform on e to the I p y minus x. Now, just for convenience, and it makes mathematics easy, you put a theta function on this y naught minus x naught, which means that you are propagating things forward in time. In principle, you can also do a time reversal, but let us assume that it is propagating forward in time, so this is 0 when that is not, condition is not met, and then there is a Fourier transform. We are talking about a free particle. So the free particle, this quantity can only depend on the momentum's dimension because of isotropy of space. So you have this quantity and plugged in there. Plug this relation into the transitivity condition. I mean, those who are really familiar with Fourier transforms can immediately guess it, because it's a convolution in Fourier space. So when you put the Fourier transform, it will be a product. Work that out. Okay, that worked that out. Reminds me to tell you one more thing. All through the lectures, I'm going to leave exercises for you. It is not necessary that you do it, but it will be good if you do it. Okay? And if you don't do it, you just assume the result, and you will be right. I mean, except in those cases where I have made a typo, but that is all right. Okay? So you can assume the results and proceed. And you have already seen at what level I'm describing things and at what level I'm throwing it for you. So this is something which you should work out. You should work out that the transitivity tells you that in Fourier space, this product should work. This is x0 to x1 to x2 in time variables. This is x1 to y0 and then y0 to x2. And in this product, this y0 better disappear magically. Okay. So that determines this form of the function f. You can actually prove it by writing a differential equation and solving, but it is easy to guess. It has to be an exponential. If it is an exponential of y0 minus x1 dot, this is another exponential with x2 dot minus y0, that y0 and y0 will cancel. Okay? So it is exponential with a constant. So this f of p, where this time difference I now denote as t, has to be some function of p exponential of that. Now there is one more thing which you can do at this stage. You can say that as t goes to very large times, these amplitudes should not diverge. That means this has to be a pure phase. So conventionally you put a minus sign and you write it as minus I f of p t. So the Fourier transform of the propagator is theta of t, which we have thrown in to say it propagates in the forward direction, times e to the minus f of some p of t. Now you are almost there. If you sort of sneak in and assume that e to the minus I omega t kind of structures, that should be the energy, then you can plug in here p square by 2m. They are doing non-relativistic mechanics. So you know e to the minus I p square by 2m time t is the Fourier transform. You do a Fourier reverse integral, you know what the propagator is. Now I am not saying you should do that, but I just wanted to connect it up with something which you know. So eventually you will find it is p square by 2m, but we will derive it in a proper manner. Okay, this is probably a good place to stop. Let me see what is the next.